In the previous video, we have seen how to calculate the capacitance per unit length and the inductance per unit length for a coaxial transmission line. Now the situation is how to calculate the losses elements due to inside the transmission line. Effectively, we have two losses mechanisms. The first mechanism is due to the finite conductivity of the dielectric material between the two conductors. This finite conductivity would represent a leakage of the current from the inner conductor to the outer conductor, or from conductor 1 to conductor 2. And this leakage will introduce power losses, which should be delivered to the load, but doesn't deliver to the load. We call these losses is the dielectric loss, and this dielectric loss is represented in the lumped element of the transmission line as a barrier conductance between the two arms or two wires of the transmission line. The other loss mechanism is due to the finite resistance or the resistance of the conductors. Effectively, if the conductor are not perfectly conductor, so we have finite conductivity, and from this finite conductivity we have some resistance inside the conductor, and this resistance multiplied by the current squared over 2 would be correspond to the conductor loss in this case. So we are interested to find out the resistance of the conductors, which introduce the conductor loss. So we have two mechanisms, as mentioned, the dielectric loss, and the dielectric loss in this case, the dissipated power in the dielectric, is mainly due to the finite conductivity of the dielectric material, which can be represented as sigma, or can also be represented as imaginary part of the permittivity, epsilon double dash. And this epsilon double dash is related to the real part of epsilon dash as the tan delta or loss tangent. So the dissipated power equals omega epsilon double dash over 2 multiplied by E dot conjugate ds. And ds here is the cross section between the conductor 1 and conductor 2. So effectively this is ds in this case. And in terms of the potential difference, this dissipated power represents the conductance per unit length multiplied by the potential difference between conductor 1 and conductor 2, V naught squared over 2. So by calculating the dissipated power energy in terms of the electric field, and this electric field is determined in terms of the applied potential, so we can say that the conductance per unit length is equal to omega epsilon double dashes over V naught square multiplied by the integration of E dot E conjugate ds. On the other hand, the current passing through the conductor C1 and C2 will introduce magnetic field lines. This dashed line is a magnetic field. And this magnetic field squared H dot H conjugate multiplied by the surface resistance of the conductor 1 plus the surface resistance of conductor 2 will correspond to the conductor loss, B conductor, or the conductor loss or power losses in the conductor. And this power losses in the conductor, it corresponds to the magnitude of the current squared over 2 multiplied by the resistance per unit length. Should be noted here, RS is the surface resistance and R is the resistance per unit length of the transmission line. So by determining the value of H as a function of the current, we can say that the resistance per unit length across the transmission line equals the surface resistance on the two conductors, conductor 1 and conductor 2, over I naught square multiplied by the current H1, H dot H conjugate dl. And should be noted here, dl is the circumference of the first conductor, C1, plus the circumference of the second conductor, C2. And Rs is the surface resistance, which equal 1 over sigma delta S, where sigma is the conductivity of the material of the conductor, and delta S is the skin depth of the conductor. And it should be noted here that the surface resistance is frequency dependent. So although these equations can be valid for magnetostatics, but the surface resistance depends on the frequency because the skin depth depends on the frequency. Okay. For the case of a coaxial cable, returning to the electric field between the inner and the outer conductor, it is the line charge density rho L naught over 2 pi rho, and it is in rho direction, and the potential difference between the two conductors would be the integration of the electric field dot dr, which is E rho d rho from rho equal to A to B. So the potential difference is rho L, the line charge density, over 2 by epsilon naught epsilon r ln B over A. This is a potential difference. Now, assuming that we have finite conductivity of the dielectric material, so the dielectric material is not ideal, so it has sigma dielectric. So in this case, there will be a current density J inside the dielectric material from the inner to the outer. And this J would be sigma dielectric multiplied by the electric field inside the dielectric. And J here to correspond to the leakage current. So the total leakage current, I leaking, would be J multiplied by the cross section of this surface. And the cross section in this case would be 2 by A, assuming that we are talking about the leakage from the inner conductor, 2 by A multiplied by 1 meter length. So this is the surface of the cylinder, 2 by A multiplied by 1 meter length. So the leakage current would be the current density J multiplied by the surface area of the leakage. So it would be 2 by A multiplied by sigma dielectric multiplied by the electric field at rho equals A. So it would be 2 by A sigma D multiplied by the electric field. It would be rho L over 2 by epsilon naught epsilon r multiplied by rho, where rho here is A. Now by eliminating this A and this A, so the leakage current would be 2 by sigma dielectric rho L over 2 by epsilon naught epsilon r. This is the leakage current. By dividing the leakage current over the voltage, the potential difference between the inner and outer, we can obtain the equivalent conductance per unit length. So in this case, we are going to divide this leakage current over the potential difference. The potential difference could be rho L naught, the line charge density, over 2 by epsilon naught epsilon r multiplied by ln B over A. So we now are going to eliminate rho L with rho L, A with A, 2 by with 2 by epsilon naught epsilon r epsilon naught epsilon r. So the remaining part, this 2 by would be coming in the denominator, 2 by sigma dielectric over ln d over d. So the conductance per unit length in terms of the conductivity of the dielectric material is 2 by sigma d over ln d over a, and its unit be Siemens per meter. It is interesting to note that the capacitance per unit length, it was 2 by epsilon ln d over a. And the conductance that we have proved is 2 by sigma dielectric over ln b over a. So it can be noted that the ratio between the conductance and the capacitance, G over C, equal sigma over epsilon. Or in other words, the conductance per unit length equal the capacitance per unit length multiplied by sigma d over epsilon. So the conductance is linearly proportional to the capacitance per unit length for the transmission line. Effectively, this relation is valid for any transmission line. So this result is actually hold for any transmission line that homogeneously fit. Okay? So the conductance G equals the capacitance multiplied by sigma d over epsilon. And effectively, sigma d over omega epsilon is 10 delta. So the conductance per unit length over omega multiplied by the capacitance per unit length equals the loss tangent of the material between the two wires. So G over omega C equal 10 delta. And once again, this relation is valid for any transmission line. It is not only for coaxial transmission line. Sometimes we present the permittivity of the material in terms of complex permittivity, such that it is epsilon dash minus j epsilon double dash. And effectively, epsilon double dash reflects the conductivity of the dielectric material. So there is a direct relation between epsilon double dash and sigma d, such that epsilon double dash is sigma d over omega epsilon dash. So in this case, we can generalize our results in terms of sigma d to be applied directly to sigma double dash. So in this case, we can say that epsilon complex is epsilon minus j sigma over omega. So in this case, sigma over omega represent epsilon double dash. Or in other words, we can say that the general form for epsilon double dash, including the losses due to the dielectric and the losses due to the conductivity of the dielectric, is epsilon double dash plus sigma over omega. So in this case, we can say that the general form for 10 delta is epsilon double dash plus sigma over omega over epsilon dash. And the first term is due to the molecular friction, and the second term is due to the conductivity, the loss conductivity. Effectively, both of them represent the losses or the conductance loss in the equivalent transmission line. So 10 delta in general is epsilon double dash over epsilon dash, assuming that sigma is nearly zero. So in this case, 10 delta is the imaginary bar of the permittivity over the real part of the permittivity. And epsilon r complex equal epsilon r multiplied by 1 minus g 10 delta. So this is the real part, and the real part multiplied by 10 delta is the imaginary part. On the other hand, If I'm talking about the losses due to the conductor loss, the conductor loss is due to the series resistance of the conductor. And in this case, we have two resistances. The resistance of the inner conductor and the resistance of the outer conductor. So, we have the total resistance is the resistance of the inner conductor RA plus the resistance of the outer conductor RB. And the resistance of the inner conductor equals the surface resistance of the inner conductor RSA multiplied by 1 over 2 by A, where A is the radius of the inner conductor and 2 by A is the circumference in this case, assuming that I'm talking about unit lengths in the direction. So effectively this is the surface 2 by A multiplied by 1 meter in the direction. In a similar way, the resistance of the outer conductor RB equals the surface resistance of the outer conductor multiplied by 1 over 2 by B multiplied by 1. Okay? Actually, this is a general form such that the inner and outer conductor may be not the same conductor type. So, here I assume that the surface resistance for the inner conductor and surface resistance for the outer conductor. So, the surface resistance for the inner conductor equals 1 over the conductivity of the inner conductor, sigma A, multiplied by the skin depth A. Similarly, the surface resistance, B, is 1 over the conductivity of the outer conductor multiplied by the skin depth delta B. And the skin depth is determined as the square root 2 over omega mu sigma. So mu here could be mu naught mu r, where mu r is the permeability of the material of the inner conductor. Actually, in most cases, it is 1 because we are talking about non-magnetic material. And the skin depth of the outer conductor would be 2 over omega mu sigma b, and mu here would be mu naught mu rb. Mu rb is the relative permeability of the outer conductor, which is nearly unity because we are talking about non-magnetic material. So, in this case, we can calculate the inner surface resistance and the outer surface resistance, and from the surface resistance we can calculate the resistance per unit length for the inner conductor and the resistance per unit length for the outer conductor, and we can calculate the total resistance per unit length. So this is how to obtain the series resistance per unit length in lossy transmission line. Okay. All right.